NWA Championship Wrestling. The AWA presents the greatest stars in professional wrestling, bringing you the best in mat action. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to AWA Championship Wrestling on ESPN. I'm Larry Nelson. The hot news in the wrestling world, or I should say the hot boiling controversy, is just exactly who is the heavyweight champion of the world. Is it Nick Bockwinkel? Is it Curt Hennig? Very controversial match at Super Clash 2 in San Francisco. Now, we're going to have that match for you as our main event this show. Later on, you're going to see Hennig against Bockwinkel from San Francisco. You make up your mind who you think the world champion is. As it stands right now, there is no champion. And as far as I know, that is the first time ever that that has been the case in the AWA. I do not know when a decision will be rendered. Soon we will find out who the world heavyweight champion is. It's got to be either Nick Bockwinkel or Curt Hennig. Or does it? Will they have a tournament? Will they make the two men wrestle again? Will they make a decision? Later on, you're going to see the match, and you can make up your own mind. Our fan of the week comes from Fairfield, Maine, and her name is Celeste Charette. I hope I'm saying your name right, Celeste. Celeste wrote out a list of her favorite wrestlers. She's got about 8 or 9 of them on here. And at number 5 is Larry Nelson. Thank you for your letter, Celeste, but I think I'll stay outside the ring to make my living. Thanks anyway. You want to be the fan of the week? You saw where to write your letter. So get it in here. We want you to be our fan of the week. Ninja Star War Games, we're going to send Celeste. Right now, let's go to the ring for a match with the Midnight Rockers.
For 15 minutes, ladies and gentlemen, introducing the team in the corner to my left, weighing in at 254 pounds from Chicago, Illinois, he is Mike Solis, and his tag team partner from Amarillo, Texas, weighing in at 242 pounds, he is Dennis Stamp. And ladies and gentlemen, weighing in at a combined weight of 485 pounds, ladies and gentlemen, the AWA Tag Team Champions, Marty Jannetty and Shawn Michaels, the Midnight Rockers! And with that, I think I'll throw it down to the tight end, Russ Francis.
Al, you're too tough on me, Al. Put me on the spot here. Saying nice things about you all night long, and then you go and do that to me. I'll get you back, Al. I'll get you back.
The Midnight Rockers, the pride of Columbus, Georgia, and San Antonio, Texas. That's home for Marty Jannetty and Shawn Michaels, and they are the tag team champions of the world. And Russ Francis, I've said it so many, many times before, and I believe it more every time I say it, and every time I see these young men, that they are indeed going to be the champions of the world, barring some injury or something like that, for a long, long time.
Well, that's what you hope for. When they talk about a dynasty in a football team, you talk about the ability to be consistent and to persevere over the years. These two young men have nothing but good things ahead of them, but as you said, if they can remain healthy in this sport, as is in any contact sport, that's what you always worry about. You wake up at night in a cold sweat wondering, can I keep going? Can I keep staying healthy?
Durability, I would guess, is the word that says it all.
That's what I meant.
Dennis Stamp. Marty Jannetty, look at him go! Wow! One of the most durable, I would guess, of all professional athletes. And this goes back a few years. It goes back to the Minnesota Vikings and a guy by the name of Jim Marshall, who played. He has more consecutive games, and I don't have the number right here at my fingertips, than any other professional football player has ever had. And you can't do that without durability.
And I can tell you why, because after having run into him many, many times, I can tell you that he is not only having played so many games, a top athlete. He's a fine man as well. And I think the games in question were 276, if I'm not mistaken. That is an awful lot of football games.
Absolutely. And you've got to play with a lot of pain. A time, and I'm sure, Russ Francis, that you yourself play. You're not totally free from pain when you go out there Sunday after Sunday after Sunday.
I'm not free from pain now, just watching these guys here.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you were going to say working with me or something. Working with Al DeRuscia.
It's a pleasure working with you, Rod. DeRuscia, that's another thing entirely.
And it's another thing entirely also right now for Dennis Staff, who is feeling the wrath of Shawn Michaels, one of the Midnight Rockers, the tag team champions of the world.
They talk about natural athletes, and you wonder, as an athlete, what the heck they mean by that. I think it is the ability to make the hard things look easy. And these two guys, Shawn and Marty, do it so well.
Absolutely. Both Shawn and Marty were great football players in their own right on the high school and collegiate level. And Shawn has just taken an elbow to the back of the head and a hard shoulder block. Now he kicks his stamp on the way in, and you see what happened. Both of them play linebackers, and they are just the right ideal size for a linebacker.
They also have the mentality that looks like when they get fired up with a couple of mad dogs. There's been times where I've wondered why they haven't given the saliva test to some of these guys before they get in the ring or on the football field.
The Midnight Rockers, the tag team champions of the world. It is Shawn Michaels feeling the shoulder block now of Mike Colas. And the elbow smash to the back of the head of Mike Colas. A knee into the middle of the back by Mike Colas. And the Irish whip across by Colas. Shawn Michaels gets out of the way and pegs in Marty Jannetty, and here he comes. Oh, elbow smash Jannetty. Body slam Jannetty. Look at this. On the shoulders of Jannetty, it's Shawn Michaels. Oh, lights out time.
That's all there is.
Incredible. Unbelievable. Fantastic. The Midnight Rockers, Marty Jannetty and Shawn Michaels. And Mike Colas, I'm sure, will long, long remember this move by Shawn Michaels. Oh. It's all over. We're at the Showboat Sports Pavilion in Las Vegas, Nevada. I'm Rod Trimgard for Russ Francis, and we'll be right back.
But first, teams from around the world prepare for a grueling 240-mile race through the Rocky Mountains. A maximum of 17 members make up each team.
He is the big mountain from Stone Mountain, Georgia. Ladies and gentlemen, he is Jerry Blackwell. The referee for this one, Big Scott Ledoux, take it away at the broadcast table, Russell and Rodney.
Al DeRuscia, you're living dangerously.
Now it's Russell and Rodney, okay? I've known Al for many, many years. I used to think the world of him. Actually, I still do. And I would like to get him in the ring or on the football field.
In the ring right now, Jerry Blackwell and Tony Leone, and outside of the ring, just off to our left, is Jerry Blackwell's newest tag team partner. And I talk about the Avalanche, and with the Avalanche, and we'll get a look at him here in just a little bit, with the Avalanche, Bob Mattson, the man who discovered him in Madison, Wisconsin. Blackwell and the Avalanche. Blackwell, 472 pounds. The Avalanche at 403 pounds. And what a devastating combination these two guys are making in the AWA.
There are a lot of gentlemen, if you would like to call them that, in the opposing locker room that are very concerned about that matchup. Those two guys together are going to be quite a team.
Over 800 pounds, almost 900.
Imagine the both came off the ropes together with elbows and hit you at once.
I don't even want to think about it.
It'd be like the entire New York Giants team coming at you all at once.
The man you just got a close-up of a little bit ago, the man in the striped shirt, is Scott Bledew, former boxer, and he can still duke it out with the best of them. And there's a drop kick by Blackwell that caught Tony Leone in the midsection. Scott Bledew with a tremendously powerful punch, but not of the explosive character and quality of a combination of Blackwell and the Avalanche. Tony Leone trying to shake off the effects of Jerry Blackwell right now.
Whoa!
You know, you mentioned Scott, too, the referee. He's coming back off of an arm injury given to him by Larry Zbyszko. There have been rumors around the locker room. I'm just passing them along. He may be coming back into the ring.
With one Mr. Larry Zbyszko. I know that neither one of them have any time for the other one.
Well, I know Scott has been rehabilitating that arm, and he is in a big hurry to get back and get a shot at Larry.
Tony Leone now working on, speaking of arms, the left arm of Jerry Blackwell. Oh, the strength of that man. He whipped Tony Leone as though he weighed 100 pounds.
You know, it's nice to take a look. I'm sorry again, Rob. I can't help it. I like to look at the face here. The gentleman that Jerry just tossed almost out of the ring, and it was just pure shock. Are you kidding me? You picked me up like a rag doll. And now here he's got him again. This has got to hurt.
In a bear hug, Leone, 230 pounds, trying somehow to get out of this hold that's got to be squeezing the breath out of him ounce by ounce until it's completely gone. Leone's going to have to do something with, he can't even get anything on a blow like that. Stick his fingers in the eyes of Jerry Blackwell or something along those lines to break the holder. It may be submission time or this may be all over. Jerry backs off himself and pops him a forearm in the solar plexus and then clubs him, hammers him across the back. Jerry Blackwell can hurt you in so many different ways than you're seeing, ways that he is really, really hurting Tony Leone, who screams in agony at each and every one of those headbutts, elbow smashes, bear hugs, you name it. Jerry Blackwell, what's he going to do now? Oh!
I can feel that from you. That's it.
Tony Leone's eyes are completely closed. He is completely out of it. And Jerry Blackwell finishes him off. Devastatingly so. Jerry Blackwell out of Stone Mountain, Georgia. You get a look in slow motion at the end.
Now, on these types of moves, you can see how he gets his entire body, which is quite a bit. Behind him in that, lands with all of his weight right in the midsection.
It's 476 pounds. And this one is all over. Russ and I will be right back.
Time limit. Weighing in at 250 pounds from Chicago, Illinois, he is Joe Pantera. And ladies and gentlemen, his opponent, weighing in at 402 pounds from Madison, Wisconsin, he is the Avalanche. Referee for this bout, Robert Warren, and down to the broadcast table.
And so we look at the Avalanche, all 402 pounds of him out of Madison, Wisconsin. We've seen him before, Russ Francis. I have been impressed, and I would guess you have too.
Well, I think each time he gets in the ring, he's learning a little bit more. And with the kind of speed he has for his size, put a little bit of knowledge along with that, and he's going to be a tough man to beat.
Uh-oh. What's happening here? Joe Pantera was trying to run away, but as the saying goes, you can run, but you can't hide. And the Avalanche found him and bounced him, literally bounced him right out of the ring.
Guys, it looked like for a second they're going out there for a jog. They're jogging around the ring, and then Pantera turned around and ran into a wall. The Avalanche.
And when avalanches come down on people, there is a dear, dear price to be paid. And so far, the people who have stepped into the ring against the Avalanche have paid the price. And Joe Pantera is feeling the effects of the 402-pound avalanche out of Madison, Wisconsin, who was discovered, as we have told you on previous occasions, by a Minnesota former political leader in the state, formerly the state treasurer of Minnesota, in a restaurant in Madison, Wisconsin. And he asked the Avalanche if he thought he might be interested in professional wrestling. The Avalanche said yes, and here he is. And Bob Patson is the name of the man we have been referring to, as the former Minnesota legislative leader. And he, again, is at ringside here at the Showboat Sports Pavilion in Las Vegas, Nevada, watching his man in action, and just about brought Joe Pantera through the canvas. What does the Avalanche have in store this time? Pantera, I do not believe, knows where he is at or what is going on. Elbow smash.
It's amazing that Pantera is getting up after this kind of a beating. Of course, right there, the Avalanche helps him up.
Off the ropes.
And Pantera is no physical slouch himself at 250 pounds. But really, so far, at least, no match for the Avalanche. The Avalanche, you can tell that he's comparatively new to the ring. A little bit rusty. Yeah, well, rusty isn't the right word. He just has not totally refined all of the moves as of yet. But he'll get there. Ooh. Nothing too difficult about that one.
Pretty basic stuff. All you have to do is hit him. He's knocking the wind. Now he's taking advantage of the fact that Pantera is wearing down his horn.
What a power body slam. And this one comes to a very, very quick end. The Avalanche didn't even have time to work up a sweat. And Bob Matson, his manager, discoverer at ringside, has a big smile on his face. And so does Jerry Blackwell, who has been watching.
Now this, to me, Rod, looks like a standard Jerry Blackwell move.
Indeed. Indeed.
I think they've been talking. How about you?
They've been talking. They've been working together. And the Avalanche is patterning a lot of what he does after the man who is now his tag team partner, Jerry Blackwell. We'll be right back.
Program, the match between Curt Hennig and Nick Bockwinkel. You decide who you think should be the heavyweight champion of the world. The AWA has not decided that yet, and we're in a very tough position right now. Having no world champion, that decision will be rendered later on. You're going to see the match. You make the call. Before we get into that, we're going to do what I call an instant replay match. There was an incident that developed between the Sheik and Buck Rock and Roll Zumoff not so long ago, and if you missed it then, let's check it out now.
Zumoff firing back and again grabbing that arm, turning it around, almost corkscrewing it out of the socket. Again, back to work on the arm. Now, he drapes it around that top rope strand. Cut the fist. Instead, uses a judo chop. And again, another judo chop by Zumhoff, who makes his home in the small community of Hamburg, Minnesota. He has wrestled out of Honolulu, Hawaii, during his days as light heavyweight champion of the world. Hamburg, Minnesota, about 40 miles due west of the Twin Cities of Minneapolis, St. Paul. Hard shoulder block here by Bashik. A field throw. And again, back to work on that left arm. Gary Rahm, that's got to be one sore appendage about now.
It certainly must be. Now, Sheik has taken some very, very bitter hits here in this particular battle, but he's fighting back. Look at that now with the face and to the eyes of Zumhoff all the time. All day long.
Sheik Antonell raking his fingernails across the back of Rock and Roll Buck Zumhoff, and then a double sledgehammer to the back twice with that slash. Zumhoff. Reversal here.
Into the turnbuckles.
And now we're going to go the other way. Back he goes. Zumhoff on fire. Here at the Showboat Sports Pavilion. Going from corner to corner and bouncing ahead of Sheik Adnan El Casey off that top turnbuckle. Like a billiard ball bounces off the cushions.
Counting it down.
Uh-oh. Oh, no! Oh, no! Boris Zumhoff is entering, has entered, pounding away on the great of rock and roll. The bell has sounded. This one is all over.
The referee's got to stop this. Look at this. Zumhoff pushing the referee out of the way.
Zumhoff is tapped.
Oh, no!
Tap Zumhoff's radio. The radio of rock and roll. Here comes Scott Ledoux. They continue to pound and hammer away.
Oh my gosh!
Adnan El Casey has gone absolutely.
This is crazy,
sir. Not only has he split the head of Zumhoff wide open, he has also completely, totally destroyed.
Adnan El Casey for the interference by Boris Zumhoff. I can't believe it. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to try to get a look at Buck. Is he going to be all right with mine?
This man is bleeding profusely from the head rod contact.
Buck Zumhoff, as there you look at Cheek Adnan LKC and Boris Zukov, more or less admiring the work that they have done. On the young man out of Hamburg, Minnesota. The Midnight Rockers came to his rescue. Scott Ledoux also came to his rescue, but it was too little, too late, as you can see.
Ladies and gentlemen,
also Gary
Darusha,
another of the excellent wrestlers
around
the referee in the AWA.
This is the sport of professional wrestling. This is absolutely terrible. Can we get some help here for Buck, please?
They've got to get a doctor or something up to that ring, Rod Trongard. This man is hurt badly.
Out of the ring.
He took a couple of tremendous clubbing, hammering type shots
from the head
with that radio to his forehead, which cut him wide open.
Rod Trongard, I can't understand what's going on. I just don't believe it.
You see Zumhoff on his feet momentarily.
He's badly hurt. He's badly hurt. He's dazed and he's stunned.
Well, he has taken some tremendous shots to the head here. There should be a stretcher here with paramedics to help him out of the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, Buck Rock and Roll Zumhoff is okay. They shattered his radio and they cut him up, but no concussion. He is back, and of course, he's after Sheik Adnan LKC. Somewhere, someday, that situation is going to get settled. Now, in just a few minutes, you are going to see the match between Henning and Bockwinkel. First, let's do this. Here it comes, the most controversial situation probably in the history of the AWA. It's happened to other organizations, but it's never happened here before where we have not had a heavyweight champion. Or at least if it has, it was before my time. I'm not familiar of any time it's happened here. But that's our situation now, and that's because of Super Clash 2. Nick Bockwinkel and Curt Hennig in a match that, Larry Zbyszko apparently got involved somewhere along the line. Stanley Blackburn was at ringside. And he has held up the decision. It looked like Curt Hennig had become the champion. But Stanley Blackburn thinks possibly Larry Zbyszko handed Curt Hennig a roll of dimes, and we have no champion. You're going to see the match. You watch very carefully, and then you can make up your own mind who you think the heavyweight champion of the world and the AWA is. Is it Nick Bockwinkel? Is it Curt Hennig? And you might be thinking how we're going to resolve this. Perhaps they'll wrestle again. Winner take all. Who knows? But now, let's go back to Super Clash at the Cow Palace in San Francisco.
And the circulation in that left arm has to be down to just about nothing by now.
Absolutely, and believe you me, Bockwinkel knows exactly what he's doing and where he's going there. I've been watching him for a few minutes now, and that's the object, is to take that arm away from Curt Hennig, and then he is really going to be handicapped.
Nick Bockwinkel, Curt Hennig. It's all part of Super Clash 2 here at the Cow Palace in San Francisco, California. As you got a shot there of the action as Larry Zbyszko is seeing it. That camera just over the shoulder. There you get another one. This is what Zbyszko and how he is seeing the match. This is how you and I are seeing it. Curt Hennig now drilling away on the champion and taking the legs out from under him, shaking that left arm, getting the circulation back, shaking it again. There's the hamstring on the champion.
I'm sure that Curt figured it's enough time that he better start taking something away from Bockwinkel, and now he's going to work on that leg, which is very smart. You can also see that he doesn't have the full use of that left arm and hand yet.
Step over, toe hold, spinning leg lock, trying to work it into a figure four.
He has got it.
Indeed, he does. And you hear the screams of Nick Bockwinkel. Bockwinkel saying no, no, no.
This, however, is not one of Curt Hennig's favorite holds, and I doubt if he has got it applied exactly right. Some of the people who really practice this thing all the time. So I don't know whether he can beat Nick with this figure four or not.
Bockwinkel, of course, is the you are referring to, who is a master of a hold such as this. No, it does not look like Curt Hennig has it locked in there exactly the way it should be, but nonetheless, it is a very, very painful hold regardless.
Absolutely it is. He doesn't have it locked down real the way it should be, or Bockwinkel wouldn't be moving, but he has made it to the ropes there, so he's going to get free.
Gary Nerusha twice kicking Bockwinkel's hand off that rope, but now Bockwinkel locks both hands on the lower rope, and the hold has been broken.
Gary Nerusha, a young referee, does such a natural job, doesn't he, Rod?
Absolutely. He is one of the very, very best. No doubt. The top referee in the AWA. Certainly the pause there was, as I was thinking, who have I seen that's better? And there isn't anybody who falls into that category as Curt Hennig works over the left leg here of Nick Bockwinkel. Draping it over that lower rope strand, dropping down on top of it. Now a knee drop onto that left leg. Now he twists it around. Bockwinkel grabs a hold of the hair and pulls Curt Hennig off. Hennig right back to it again, however. Trying to apply the figure four again, and lock it in there more firmly, but he never gets the chance. As Bockwinkel, knowing the deep trouble he would be in if he would allow that to happen, grabbed a hold of the hair, and Hennig was unable to lock it in. Shots to the midsection, to the head, by the champion. The cover here by the champion. He gets a two count, and no more. Bockwinkel and Hennig. Hennig and Bockwinkel. Here is a knee into the solar plexus, and Hennig is cartwheeled to the mat as Larry Zbysko looks on. It is Bockwinkel covering and getting a two count.
You can tell Bockwinkel's getting weak in that left leg, though.
They exchange thundering right hands. Both of them hit the deck. Bockwinkel, first back to the attack. Bouncing the head of Kurt Hennig off that top turnbuckle. A lot of people say that.
You can get cauliflower ears on that turnbuckle in a hurry.
A hard shot to the head off the side headlock by Nick Bockwinkel, who is limping around that ring as you look again at Larry Zbysko looking on. Very, very intently, not taunting either man, watching both of them, I'm sure, because he has been promised a shot at the winner. And speaking of shots, a tremendous one there by Hennig, and a reversal here by the champion. The ring just about came apart as Bockwinkel whipped Hennig into that corner, sensing he has Hennig in trouble. Oh, it looked like three. And there you see what Zbysko is seeing. Both of these men showing tremendous amount of endurance and resiliency. Up and over goes Kurt Hennig, and he gets a count of two on the champion. Of the champion off that canvas, punching it again and turning him over. A cover here for Kurt Hennig. Both men giving it absolutely everything they've got. A hard shot here by Hennig. Bockwinkel certainly seems the worse for wear of the two, staggering across the ring, swinging wildly with the right hand. Atomic drop here by Kurt Hennig. The youth may be telling here. A rollover. Up. It doesn't get any closer than three. 2-3, then that. And Bockwinkel answers back with a shot to the solar plexus. Bockwinkel now with a whip. Bockwinkel. Look at that flying cross body. Again, a two count. As Bockwinkel missed the clothesline, it was Kurt Hennig ducking under the clothesline and then coming off the rope, slingshotting off the rope with that coming cross body, and now drilling him again, a somersault here by Kurt Hennig, but again, he can get only the two count.
Looks like Kurt Hennig's got his second win here.
Wow. Indeed. He may be setting him up for the axe. Let's see. There it is. A cover again. However, here you see Nick Bockwinkel grabbing a hold of that lower rope, and the hold has to be broken. Kurt Hennig parting with the axe. And now, is it the pile driver? It is. But again, the champion is over near the rope. Kurt Hennig, knowing he can't get the pin there, takes him to his feet. Oh, what a drop kick! Bockwinkel may be out on his feet. However, instinctively, he reaches back for that something that only the champions have and is able to kick his way out one more time. Hennig drills him with a right hand, whips it across the ring, and Bockwinkel comes back with a clothesline of his own.
He pulled that one right out of the bottom of the barrel, didn't he, Roddy?
Oh, he did.
That's experience there that you're seeing. Just instinct and experience.
The two of them simultaneously making their way to their feet. And the war goes on. Buckwinkle now picking up Curt Hennig, dropping him flat on his back. However, unable to roll over and cover him. Front face lock, side hip lock. Here's Curt Hennig. But both men indeed simultaneously on the deck again.
Now, what's he doing?
Once Larry's a best of battle line as he is saying something here to Curt Hennig.
I can't believe this. What did Zbyszko do over there?
I don't know. All he did was he said something to Curt Hennig. Hennig comes up and hammers away. Count of one, two, and three.
I cannot buy that, Rod. Larry Zbyszko had to give Curt Hennig something to punch the Buckwinkle that hard.
Wow.
I'm not buying this at all. Look at this. Look at Zbyszko going right to Curt Hennig.
A voice of experience here at ringside, Ray the Crippler Stevens. There you see Curt Hennig and Larry Zbyszko. They shake hands as the championship has changed hands here as a part of Super Clash 2 at the Cow Palace in San Francisco.
I cannot buy this. I'm going to go up and put my 2 cents worth in. I'm sorry, Rod, but I think that Larry Zbyszko passed Curt Hennig something there.
Ray the Crippler Stevens making his way to the ring. Stanley Blackburn is in the ring, saying something to referee Gary Nerusha. And now Ray the Crippler Stevens is saying something. Meantime, you see Curt Hennig very, very proudly wearing that championship belt and raising both hands in a sign of victory as Ray the Crippler Stevens and Stanley Blackburn, the commissioner and president of the AWA, talk to the referee. And now it is Ray the Crippler Stevens tugging away at Larry Zbyszko and pointing to a bunch of coins, apparently, that Zbyszko somehow has had in his possession, as you can see there. And they indeed have given, oh, I did not see that happen myself. They indeed have given. Curt Hennig, as Hennig was laying there on the canvas, and Zbyszko went over and said something to him.
Heavyweight champion of the world.
Still, the conversation goes on. Inside that ring, Gary Nerusha has summoned the ring announcer into the ring. And we will be listening here as to what announcement is to be made after this confab between Stanley Blackburn, Ray the Crippler Stevens, and referee Gary Nerusha. And now, Larry Zbyszko pushes Ray the Crippler Stevens away, and Stevens does not take highly for that, I'll tell you.
The camera caught it, and we're going to have to go over the film and take it.
Hey, I know you're in love with Nick Bogwinkle, but he beat him right into the ring. You're going to believe this all over the hill, washed up jerk.
The belt is held up. The man is champion. The championship committee can review the tape.
Well, what happened? Did you or did you not see Larry Zbyszko hand Curt Hennig a roll of dimes? In my mind, I'm sure that Larry Zbyszko did just exactly that, but maybe you saw it from a different angle than I did. I don't know what's going to happen. Stanley Blackburn is going to make the decision. I think Zbyszko was involved, but maybe they can't prove it. Whatever, we'll find out. Curt Hennig and Nick Bockwinkel on whether or not Larry Zbyszko got involved and was there a roll of times and who is the world champion, and it's driving everybody nuts that right now we don't have a world champion, but we'll get more on that as soon as we can. There will be a decision, and I'm sure somebody, well, obviously somebody is going to be very upset whichever way the decision goes. I think they should just make them wrestle again, decide it all over, and maybe ban Zbyszko from the building. What do you think? You're involved in this. You're the fan. What do you think about the whole situation? Speaking of fans, I got a fan of the week I want to congratulate again here. Celeste Charette, and Celeste, I hope I'm pronouncing your last name correctly. Celeste wrote us from Fairfield, Maine, and if you want to be the fan of the week, that's where you can send your cards and letters, and we'll consider you for a fan of the week. And again, she's got eight different names here as her favorite wrestlers, and she's got Larry Nelson as number five. I don't know. What do you think? Maybe I should start working out? Huh? No? Whatever. No, I'll stay on this side of the ring. See you next week.